Good morning to everybody. I am Dr. Subhash Kakhandaki. I am a former senior scientist of DRDO and currently director of National Institute of Vedic Science, Bangalore, and founder, president of Prasanna Venkata Research Foundation Trust, Bangalore. Last week, you have heard a wonderful lecture on ancient Indian science and technologies, and last lecture Dr. Y.S. Gayatri has initiated a talk on Vedic physics and its relevance to today science and importance of ancient Indian knowledge wisdom in the current scenario. She was supposed to take up this week also this lecture. Unfortunately, she is not well. Therefore, I stepped in to continue the topic of Vedic physics. I delivered a lecture on Vedic physics few years back in different forum. Probably that has come to me very handy in a short period to talk about it. So now I will explain in details through the slides. So please look at the slides carefully. I hope it is very clearly visible to all of you. In continuation of the last week lecture on the ancient Indian physics by Dr. Y.S. Gayatri, I'd like to continue with touching the some basic aspect of the Vedic physics and then get on into the core subject. Before we could get into the subject, let's understand the how do you interpret the Vedic text and what methodological approach needs to be followed in terms of Vedic text and terms. As an other corroboratory material was available, as no other corroboratory material was available, we were required to take a recourse to the methodological approach in respect of interpretation of Vedic text and terms. This method is known as yogic method. Here, word is interpreted through the analysis of its derivation in the light of field of meaning prescribed for its root in conjunction with any prefix or suffixes used as per the rules of the grammar. Ancient rishis believed to be seers of the Veda mantras, and other scholars had emphasized etymology. That means, all of you know that what is etymology? It is in the study of the history of words, where they are from and how their form and meaning have changed over a period of time, and its interpretation of the Vedic terms. Four of the most famous Sanskrit linguists are Yaksha, 16th to 15th century, that is Nirukta of Yaksha, Panini, all of you know, and Katyayana, that 2nd century of BC, and Patanjali, a 2nd century of BC. In ancient Indian physical science, it was called as a Padartha Vidya or Shastra. The ancient Sanskrit scripture Sankhya enumerates a 25 categories which are instrumental for creation of the matter and universe, but still traditionally more identified with five elementary causes which are known as Apayu Mahabhutas, and these are included among the said 25 elements. Mahat, Buddhi, Ahankara, Manas. A five sense are gone, that becomes nine, and five karmendriyas and the five organs of action, that becomes 14, and tanmatras and five subtle elements, that becomes 19, and five mahabhutas, that is the panchabhutas, the gross elements, earth, water, air, fire and ether. So it becomes 24, and these are the 24 evolutes, and together with the Purusha, the individual soul who joins the Prakriti to initiate the process, and the number becomes the 25. Original Vedic names of the five are Akasha, Vayu, Agni, Jala and Prithvi. Over a period of time, this knowledge of Panchamahabhutas was spread to West and East countries, particularly Greece, which was well-known knowledge and learning center in the West. In the West, they ignored the Akasha and accepted other four, that is air, fire, water and earth or soil, and continued to be mentioned as a fundamental elements. As you know, modern physics established a system based on a scientific rules and a well-tested laboratory. However, as Vedic science in ancient texts, whatever they say in a few mantras, no record of any experimental support is available. The elements of creation enumerated by Sankhya, which presents the whole sum of structure of Vedic physics. But then we study the Vedic physics in comparison with the modern science. Out of 25 elements of Sankhya, we may have to omit 11 elements which are related to biological development of matter. The balance of 14, that is Prakriti, Mahat, Ahankara and 5 Tanmatras and 5 Mahabhutas and Purusha is generally considered for comparative study. This comparative study is to show that Vedic physics is the seed of the true knowledge of high order, and varieties and potential deserves respect, full attention and a full of purpose. In view of this, I selected the elements of creation enumerated by Sankhya, which represents the entire structure of Vedic physics. Let us take some simple example of a comparison of modern science and Vedic science interpretation. A modern science has established that a planetary orbits of four solar systems are elliptical, and so are the bodies of these planets. But Veda says that orbital motion being the result of a centripetal forces working upon the body in motion, all orbits are elliptical, so also its bodies. This phenomena is universal, but respective calculation may be done on a circular basis. For example, Vedic noun for ellipse is a trinabhi or a triple centered. A circle having one center is called chakra. By using trinabhi chakra mentioned in the Rig Veda, some of what we have explained above. Now let us take the second example of the modern science is a space travel. Bharadvaj Muni's Brihad Vaimanik Shastra identifies an aircraft as a means of travel within the country. One country to another and planet to another planet, that is a space travel. His book also has indication about intergalactic travels. The modern Earth satellites were also known. One note of Rishis Vishwamitra to have established a Trishanku, what is known today as a space station or stationary satellite. The name Trishanku reveals the technique of such a launch. That is why an antidote cannot be dismissed as any fancy imagination. Tri is a tree and Shanku is a conicular body. Together, the compound word means these stages are conical body, which is now so well established due to modern science, and most important part is use of three and conical shape a rockets. The scientists have determined to overcome the gravitational forces, direct firing from surface fails to provide the necessary lift, but the three stages provides a conicircular body to get the required thrust. Obviously, Trishanku is not an imaginary concept. These two examples illustrate how through the etymological approach one can arrive the scientific meaning from the Vedic text. Sankhya treatise presents Vedic science of a creation in a precise sequence of cause and effects. We are seeing a modern physical science is also presented in cause and effect sequence. Science of knowledge is truth. To clarify further, Sutra 1/161 of Sankhya is being given below with its English translation. This sutra explains the elements of Srishti Vidya, that science of creation, that is the physics. It says, Sattva Rajasa Tamasvam Samyastaha Prakritihi Prakriti Prakriti Mahan Mahato Ahankaraha Ahankara Panchatanmatri तन्मात्रेभ्यः स्थूलभूतानि पुरुषः इति पञ्च इमस्त्रिः गुणाः. So, translating in English, as substituting the terms of modern physics, the above sutra would read as some of the thinking like following. The in existence, motion and transformation, what remains conserved in energy, from the energy emerges the primordial fireball. From multiplicity of identity emerge five grade of quantum levels, double number of senses and organs of action. From the quantum level emerges five mega causatives of relativity and Purusha. Sankhya presents the Vedic physics with this a concise expression. This Sankhya Vedic physics also covers nuclear physics, a particle physics, a quantum physics, physics of relativity and astrophysics and more. The sloka in earlier slide also covers biological creation as shown in bracket in the summary. Hence, we can omit at the moment since we are dealing with only physics here. We can note further that energy has no cause of its existence. It eternally exists and conserves itself in any or all the three stages of being. Energy commences the cause and effect sequence as far as a causative is related to the field of relativity. These forms of workshop of creation wherein matter get transformed from energy, the material cause of the universe moving under the stimulus Purushaha, which again is a causeless in eternal existence and its instrumental cause of a creation. The interaction between the Purusha and Prakriti, that is energy, results in above work process, that's workshop, coming up and universe being churned out of the same. Purusha is the most important factor that causes the emergence of the cosmos. Therefore, the entire Purusha Sukta from Yajurveda needs to be looked into the unreveal the a physics of creation. Sankhya enumerates Prakriti as the first element for creation. Creation is a scientific subject and Vedic noun Prakriti, out to be analyzed, determine what its connotes. To facilitate this, Sankhya virtually defined it it in unambiguous terms, which also goes to state as well as establish a law of modern physics. Let us look at this angle to start with. Sankhya says, sattva rajasam tamasam samvatsam prakritihi. It means prakritis that which remain in the state of conservation in existence, motion and transformation or condensation. Now let us examine each word for better clarity. Sattva. The tva suffix renders the word an abstract noun of sat. Later meaning present or eternally present, a presence or presupposes existence. Whereas a dictionary states that sattva to mean being, existence, entity, reality. All the four meanings are akin, but existence has been used in this translation to convey the sense. Now, prakriti, material cause, let us look at one by one. The rajasa, the rule of a grammar which adds suffix. Here you can see as to the root ranj, to attain, to attach, makes the yan invisible and noun rajasa comes into being. One of the meaning of the said root is to move, hence this derivation connotes the motion. Tamas, this noun is also derived with the suffix as, tamas, T-A-M-A-S, as in the previous para from the tam, and means inclination. A lexicons, that is a linguistic vocabulary, explains that the inclination is towards the transfer, transformation or condensation. The am in the quote denotes the sense of being related to. Now let's see samvatsaha. This is the two words compound, samya and avastaha. Samya is the abstract noun of sama, literally meaning the sameness or a quality, or the avastha is the state of being. Thus the compound means that the state of being remains the same or equal or conserved. Two compound words, pra plus kriti, define prakriti as that in which under any of the three states, namely the state of existence or of a motion or that of transfer or transformation or a condensation to some other form, it remains the same. It does not undergo any loss or gain. In other words, prakriti cannot be created nor can be annihilated. Under the state of being, it remains just as it was prior to said state. What is prakriti? Vedic seer says it is the upadana karana or material cause of universe or creation. Said material cause can be identified in any of its state so named. First, it exists in eternally present. Secondly, it may be in the state of motion. And thirdly, it is capable of transferring or transforming itself into other form, but through such behavior or activity, its total entity remains the same. It is neither loses even iota nor adds anything to itself. The three states of being called a guna or guna of the said prakriti. Guna means a quality, peculiarly attributes or the property. Guna means a quality, a peculiarity, attributes or a property. Said prakriti has three attributes, namely one is eternal existence or presence, second is motion, or third is a transformation or a condensation. It has no other attributes. They come into play as a Prakriti causes material universe to emerge and function. Veda says that Prakriti is a jada or inert. Inert entity can certainly exist, but it will remain totally incapable to undertake any activity whatsoever of its own. If any inert object displays activity, a cause must be sought elsewhere. This brings one to the conclusion that other two gunas or attributes come into play only when they are impelled by a factor other than the Prakriti itself. In other words, Prakriti remains inert and behaves as such even when under the influence of its second and third gunas. This activity of motion, etc., are caused to be undertaken by it under the influence of some other entity or being. So far, Prakriti is concerned, under the influence of any of the three attributes, it stays inert and continue to behave that way. It is thus to conclude that attributes rajas, tamas stay dormant within the sattva and appear only when Prakriti is caused to materialize and further to the extent so caused. This cause has been mostly forcefully advocated by Vedas as the source of all the sciences and is called a Purusha, enumerated by the Sankhya at the last. Now, we'll just glance to the comparison with the modern science. Modern physics too recognizes the material cause of the universe and names its energy. The energy exists eternally, and it was, it is, and it shall eternally continue to be. It is not born, nor does it die. It can neither be created nor destroyed. No gain or loss occur to it. In other words, it conserves itself. These attributes have been defined as a laws of conservation of energy, as follows, as all of us knows in modern science. The energy neither be created nor can be destroyed. It can be converted from one form to another or transferred from one object to other, but total amount of energy remains a constant or conserved. Now compare this law as stated above with what Sankhya says. The first sentence is, that is, energy cannot be created nor destroyed, just states the first attributes stated by Sankhya, that is sattva, that is existence. The part portion of the second sentence, reading it, may be transformed from one form to another, is the third attribute's name, tamas, by Sankhya. And finally, the mid portion, that is transformed from one object to another, is what the second attribute called rajas is conveying. Finally, last part of the above quoted laws relating to total amount of energy is the constant or conserved, is stating the meaning of the samvasta, that is the state of being same or equal. The only difference is that Sankhya has started three attributes in respect of what has been named by Prakriti, named it as a Prakriti, while modern physics in asserting them in respect of energy. Let us clarify this situation in the following ways. According to the modern physics, all matter is energy. The Einstein formula of E is equal to mc square provides the key to calculate how much energy is locked up in any particular form of a matter. As such, the entire matter of universe is but a condensation of energy. In other words, energy is the very cause pointed out above, which according to the Veda is a Prakriti, Upadana Karana, that is a material cause of creation. Here it is interesting to see that two nouns, one from the modern physics and other from Veda converge on the same activity, that is a creation of the matter. Another important standpoint of modern physics is regarding the state of being of energy. When energy is at rest, it is in the state of equilibrium and it is sort of a motionless state, balanced all round. In this state of being, energy remains totally at rest but most certainly exists. The energy of motion is a kinetic energy. In Vedic terminology, this is a state of rajas, as has already been explained earlier. Lastly, the physics declares that all the matter in whatever form of a form is energy condensed within the appearance of that form. Each and every object is a storehouse of energy, and in any position, the energy forming the same being potential called a potential energy, as discussed earlier, this state of third guna of the Prakriti named as a tamas. From this discussion, one can conclude that whatever Veda is saying about Prakriti is being confirmed and corroborated by modern physics in respect of energy. In other words, what has been named as a Prakriti by Veda has been recognized by modern physicists of today as energy. Here, both denotes a same elements in their respective language. In Vedic terminology, there is another word which more akin to a English term in energy, which has been derived from the Greek term origin, meaning is or origin, a meaning is act, meaning activity. This is the Shakti, which is an abstract noun from the root sak, denoting the power. Energy is too synonymous of power. That is why Shakti means a capability or strength to execute the desired work or activity. Yet Veda preferred to name Upadana Karana, material cause of the universe, is a Prakriti. Hence, let us analyze the word Prakriti little deeper aspect of it. Prakriti is a pra plus kriti. So, pra prefixing meaning a forward, a forward, in front, on, forth, and kriti means act of doing, making, performing, manufacturing and composing. So let us stop this week up to this, and we take forward other aspect of it in the following week. Thank you for your patience, watching and hearing. Thank you very much for patient listening of this week lecture. Whatever I have presented here, it's a collection from various researchers, authors, the books, Vedic text, and compilation of all that. I must thank them, all the authors and all the researchers, who have made a significant contribution and continue to be contribute in this domain. And I am just instrumental here to present this and highlight the importance of the Vedic science and its relevance to the modern science. Thank you very much once again. Look forward to meet you in the coming weeks. Thank you.